Good morning, and welcome to Matthew's United Methodist Church online worship. We are so glad that you have chosen to worship with us today, and we hope that throughout this time of worship that you will be inspired, that you will be filled with the joy of this special season. My name is Corey Millette, and I am one of the pastors here at Matthew's, and it is with great joy that I welcome you this day. Today, we do celebrate the third Sunday of Advent. It's hard to believe that we are already on week three, but friends, it is here. And so this season of great anticipation is one of wonder and awe. And we hope that you will be filled with that during our time of worship together this morning. If you are new to worshiping with us, we welcome you as well today. And we want you to know that Sunday morning worship throughout this season of Advent is going to be built around the theme called The Many Moods of Christmas. And throughout those worship service messages, we are going to be trying our best to shape the scenes of Christmas via human feelings and emotions. Today, you are in for a real treat as Pastor Chuck will be bringing a message to us entitled Christmas Laughter, which is rooted in the scripture of Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. We are going to have a chance to laugh at this incredible joke that God actually plays on Joseph, this young man who learns that his young fiance, Mary, is actually pregnant. And he knows that he isn't the father. So I look forward to hearing what Pastor Chuck brings for us later in the service. At this time, friends, I invite you that if you have a candle near you, to go ahead and light it as we begin our time of worship. And we are going to be turning our attention now to the Freeman family, who will be lighting our Advent wreath for us today. Let's take a look.
Hear now a scripture from Isaiah chapter 12, verses 2 through 6. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and I will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation, and you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known his deeds among the nations, proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be known in all the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy, O royal Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel. The third candle on the Advent wreath is called the Shepherd's or Joy Candle. It remembers the first in a long line of people who joyfully shared the good news of the Savior's birth. The candle is a different color, reminding us that our period of waiting is half over. Today, the Freeman family has lit three candles: hope, peace, and the pink candle of joy.
See you. Jesus come. One star burns in the darkness, shines with the promise, Emmanuel. One child born in the stillness, living within us, Emmanuel. We're singing glory, glory. Let there be peace, let there be peace. Singing glory.
Friends, God created us to be in community with one another. He didn't intend for us to walk this life alone. And especially throughout this Advent season, we have the opportunity to extend God's glory and God's love to one another. And so I encourage you to pick up your phone and maybe make a phone call or send a text to someone that God has placed on your heart this day to extend God's love to them and his grace to them as well. On behalf of all of us leading you in worship this morning, may the peace of Christ be with you all.
Merry Christmas, Matthews United Methodist Church. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Merry Christmas, and may the peace of Christ be with you.
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 And also with you.
The peace of Christ be with you.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Peace and Christ will be with you.
Merry Christmas, Matthews United Methodist Church.
From the contemporary team at Matthews United Methodist Church.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Merry Christmas!
Again, I welcome you to Matthew's United Methodist Church. And if you are a guest with us, we extend a special word of welcome to you today. And we are just so thankful that you have chosen to worship with us. In fact, we would love to encourage you that our first-time guest, we go and visit our church's website and fill out the guest connection form. During the season of Advent, we are doing something very special for our guests. We will actually donate $5 in your name to one of our local ministry partners. And so we encourage you to extend the invitation to worship with us to your friends and to your neighbors so that we might continue to make an impact not just within these walls, but far beyond within our community as well. Also, I'd like to encourage you to be able to stay up to date on all of the things that are happening in and through the life of ministry at Matthew's, that you would take the time to visit our website and to subscribe to our Friday celebration newsletter. This is where you can find the most comprehensive list of events and announcements. All of this can be done on the Connect tab at matthewsumc.org. If you haven't had a chance to do so already, I'd love to invite you to go ahead and put in the comment section who is worshiping with us this morning. We love to know who is gathered each hour for worship, so please let us know who is out there and who is watching this morning. We also want to make sure that you do not miss anything when it comes to worship here at Matthew's United Methodist Church. And so I'd like to encourage you to visit YouTube and go to youtube.com/MatthewsUMC and to take the time to actually set up your notifications so that right before the service at 9:30 and 11, you will be notified that we are going to have our on-demand worship services there. So please be sure to subscribe to that. Well, friends, one of the most incredible things that we can do during this season of Advent and beyond is to be able to unify ourselves together through the gift of prayer. And so at this time, I would love to invite you that wherever you may be worshiping with us, that you would join me in going to God in prayer this morning. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we come humbly before you with so many different thoughts and feelings on our mind. Father God, each of us are just in different places and spaces on this third Sunday of Advent. And God, for many of us, this season of anticipation and wonder is a time of joy. It's a time of excitement. It's us waiting on the edge of our seat for the gift of your Son, Jesus. But God, for many of us, we also recognize that this is a season of concern, of loss, of doubt, and of great question. And God, the honest truth is that I think this year in 2020, more of us are experiencing that feeling of loneliness and confusion during this Advent season. God, for we are just deeply longing for community. We are longing for peace in our world. And God, we are just deeply anticipating the healing that only you can bring to each and every one of us. And so God, we recognize this season as one of joy, but also one that can bring great loneliness. And so Father God, this day I pray for our community. I pray for those, wherever they may be in their journey with you, God, that this day, in this moment, they will turn their eyes and their hearts to you, and they will be open to your nudging and your guidance in their life. That we would all know without a shadow of a doubt that we are not alone, but that we are claimed by you, that we are your sons and daughters, and that we need not fear loneliness. For God, with you in our hearts, we can be filled with joy. We can overcome the things of this world. We can leap over the hurdles that we might be facing in our life, whether it's financially, our marriages, friendships. God, whatever those relationships might be, we know that you can mend them, that you can bring joy and peace to them. So God, we pray that in our hearts this day. And God, we pray for healing. Not just in our own life, God, but we pray for physical healing of those who are still encountering this pandemic. For our medical professionals, God, who are on the front lines right now, who are tired, who are weary, who have been facing death and loss every single day, God, for months now. God, we continue to place them in your hands. We ask that you bring them peace, that even in the midst of the chaos of this season, that they would find glimmers of joy and places of hope. And God, we continue to pray for this community that we call Matthews, that God, you would place your protection around us and that you would keep our people safe and healthy as we continue to navigate through this year of 2020 together. And Father God, we place all of these prayers and those on our hearts and minds at your feet this day. And all of God's children said, Amen. Well, friends, it is because you give that Matthews United Methodist Church is able to reach far beyond the walls of this church building. In fact, just a few weeks ago, we had the opportunity to open our large parking lot for Drive Through Bethlehem, which was a wonderful partnership between our children's ministry, our worship and arts team, our Rainbow Express ministry, a local partner for us. So many different wonderful ministries coming together to be able to bring the gift to our community of the birth of Jesus Christ with a special nativity and special gifts. And then following that, our United Youth Ministry was able to host a wonderful drive-in movie night. Friends, incredible things are happening here and happening within our community because of your faithful generosity. And so this morning, if you call Matthews United Methodist Church your spiritual home, I hope that you will join your gifts together with many others from our community to continue to make that impact. I encourage you to visit our church's website to be able to give, to look at the slide on the screen right now, to be able to see how you might text to give or give through our Realm platform. However you might feel comfortable, we just give thanks for your generosity and the joyful hearts that you give with. So know that you are making an impact even through this unique season of ministry that we share together. So at this time, may you give with great joy and generosity.
Didn't come in glory. Today's scripture reading is going to come from the book of Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. It's going to be from the New Revised Standard Version. Now, the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had born a son, and he named him Jesus. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Have you ever wondered what the world would be like if Adam had never taken a bite of that forbidden fruit? Now, I've always been drawn to the writings of C.S. Lewis, and Lewis once wrote a science fiction fantasy called Perelandra. And in the book, Lewis envisioned a planet where Adam never took that bite. On Perelandra, paradise is unspoiled, and its inhabitants exist in the pristine state that God intended from the very beginning. But one of the unique things about Perelandra is thunder. Now, in our world, thunder is frightening. It sounds a bit like anger in the heavens, but on Perelandra, thunder is the sound of God laughing. Now, do you think God laughs? Does God have a sense of humor? Now, this morning, what I'd like to do is to try to answer that question with a resounding yes. God has a sense of humor. Now, I want to urge you to laugh every once in a while during my sermon today because it is titled Christmas Laughter. Jack Benny, one of the great master comedians, used to warn people about not laughing, and he would say, every time you suppress a laugh, it goes back down in your body and it spreads to your hips. Now, we certainly don't want that to happen to us, do we? Throughout the ages, philosophers have debated over what it is that tickles our funny bone and causes that joyous explosion of air out of our lungs and across our vocal cords, which we call laughter. Aristotle, the great Greek philosopher, wasn't big on laughter. And according to his thinking, that which was laughable was considered to be a subcategory of the ugly. But thinkers who walk in the way of Jesus, for the most part, have tended to look upon laughter as a gift of God. I immediately think of Dante, who called, you remember his literary classic that he called the Divine Comedy? And yet among the great thinkers of the world, about the only agreement we can find is that humor is defined by two elements: incongruity and surprise. G.K. Chesterton defined humor as the sudden perception of incongruity. Now, that would be when two things we usually keep in separate compartments of our brain suddenly cross paths inside our head, and the result is laughter. For example, did you hear the story about that bait shop along Highway 49 down near Lake Wiley? One day, a member of today's young adult generation pulled up to that bait shop, and he was riding his motorcycle, and the young guy, he had tattoos, he had pierced ears, pierced nose, pierced eyebrows, and a pierced tongue. Now, the old bait shop proprietor had been smoking unfiltered Camel cigarettes for the last 50 years. So this example of today's youth subculture was completely outside of his experience. And so the young guy walked in and he asked, saying, "You got any ball peanuts?" And the bait shop owner stared at that young man's face as he stubbed out his cigarette. And then he came out from behind the counter to examine him more closely. And finally, I mean, he's still staring at the young man's face, and he asked, "Now, boy, tell me, exactly where were you standing when that tackle box exploded?" Now, tattoos and body piercings are two of the hippest trends in today's culture, but they were interpreted by this man as the aftermath of a terrible accident. You see what I'm talking about, incongruity and the surprise that comes when you perceive an incongruity and it leads to laughter. Maybe you heard about that group of New York City archaeologists who found traces of copper wire dating back 100 years, and they had dug down only about 10 feet, and they concluded that their ancestors already had a telephone network more than 100 years ago. Well, not to be outdone by the New Yorkers, a few weeks later, we've got a group of California archaeologists who dug down to a depth of 20 feet, and shortly afterwards, a story in the LA Times read, "California archaeologists finding traces of 200-year-old copper wire have concluded that their ancestors already had an advanced high-tech communications network 100 years earlier than the New Yorkers." Well, one week later, the Charlotte Observer reported the following. After digging as deep as 30 feet in his backyard, Fred Yancey, a self-taught archaeologist, reported that he found absolutely nothing. Fred has therefore concluded that 300 years ago, North Carolina had already gone wireless. Well, humor, it just has to surprise us. And it causes us to consider things in a different light. But let's go back to my original question. Does God have a sense of humor? Well, have you read the Christmas story lately? I mean, what sounded like a terrible accident turned out to be the greatest story ever told. Judging by this story, I believe that God has the greatest sense of humor the universe has ever known. In our scripture lesson for this morning is Joseph. His life is marching along in one direction, and then life, well, it just takes a very different turn, and Joseph doesn't think it is one bit funny. Joseph was a carpenter. I envision him as a kind of punch-the-time-clock sort of guy who would come home at night, pet the dog, read the paper, retire early to bed, and then rise at daybreak to get out to the job site. We know that Joseph didn't talk much. In fact, even though there are 15 cities in the United States that are named after Joseph, there's no record of a single word from his mouth in all of the Bible. And some of you may know what it's like to be married to a man like that. You know, the proverbial, strong, silent type. Joseph was quiet and practical. He liked working with wood, a material that you could measure and cut and work with your hands. Joseph loved Mary, for she was honest, simple, a down-home young girl, the kind you could settle down with and raise a family. And Mary and Joseph, they thought they had it all. They had love, they had trust, they had dreams. And the date was set and the china was registered and the invitations were in the mail. And then one day, Mary said, "Joseph, I need to tell you something. I'm going to have a baby." And suddenly Joseph's simple, perfect life, it dissolved into a world of pain. And Mary continued saying, "Now, Joseph, there's nothing to worry about. You see, there was an angel." You can imagine Joseph's response. "Yeah, sure, an angel." I mean, did it prove too much to ask of this young man? According to their tradition, when Mary started to show, Joseph had no choice but to put her away, to distance himself from her. I mean, Jewish culture and their religious understanding, it just demanded it. But one night before he did so, an angel appeared to Joseph and said, verse 20 of our lesson, "Joseph, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. The child within her is from God. This is Emmanuel, the long-awaited fulfillment of the prophecy, God with us." Now, although our scripture lesson doesn't say so, I believe Joseph's first reaction to this announcement was, "Now, wait a minute, angel. I didn't sign up for this. All I want to be is a carpenter, to have a wife and a house and a yard and a family." And as he's thinking these things, you can imagine the great laughter in the heavens, thunder from Paralandra, if you will. How about you today? I mean, have you ever experienced one of God's surprises? If you were to ask the Wilson family, Karen and I, we would tell you we got two gifts in Texas and another one born right here in Matthews. And oh yes, there is our Mackenzie, our little surprise, the caboose at the end of the family. That was the kind of surprise that God had in store for a white-haired woman by the name of Sarah. Do you remember her in the Old Testament? Sarah was so old she had to squint to focus on the baby in her arms, who wasn't her grandson, but was her very own son. Her husband, Abraham, he's 100 years of age. The book of Genesis tells us that when Abraham heard he was going to be the father at such an advanced age, why, he fell on the ground laughing. Someone has suggested that he was laughing just to keep from crying. At another point in this story of Abraham and Sarah, why, Sarah was eavesdropping from behind the flap of the tent when she heard God's news that she would bear a son. She giggled until tears began streaming down her cheeks. But God got the last laugh. God told Abraham and Sarah that their child would be a boy, that he would be named Isaac. And do you know what Isaac means there in Hebrew? It means laughter. Does anyone hear laughter from heaven this morning? We find some of our best laid plans getting derailed, don't we? And then God giving us the last thing that we ever expected. I find that couples that are about to be married are people who are deeply invested in their plans. My experience has been that most times they are simply unwilling to allow any detail to fall out of their control. Now, you can't imagine some of the brides that I've encountered in my day with their lists and their notebooks and their diagrams. But can't you hear God laughing? Sure. Go ahead, plan your wedding to the smallest detail, but you just try to plan your marriage that way. We human beings, I mean, let's admit it, we try so hard to create tidy little worlds where we're in complete control, and just when we think we've managed to do so, that laughter from heaven sounds again. Any of you ever see that wonderful movie from a few years ago? One of my favorites. It's titled Remains of the Day, starring Anthony Hopkins. And in the film, Hopkins portrays Stevens, who's the head butler of the palatial Darlington Hall in Oxfordshire, England. And as a butler, Mr. Stevens is compulsive, meticulous, and he's a stickler for details. Before dinner, he takes a ruler and he goes down the table, measuring the distance between the edge of the table and the water glass at each place setting. And he says things like, "Forgive me for being personal, but may I wish you a pleasant holiday?" I mean, his whole life is defined by being a butler, even to the point that one night when a dinner party is being held at the estate, he's told by a maid that his father, who had been ill, has just died upstairs, and Stevens replies, "I am indeed sorry, but matters of the utmost importance are happening under this roof tonight." And so instead of attending to his father on his deathbed, he continues his work. But for me, the drama of the story occurs when a wonderful woman on his staff, the head housekeeper, falls in love with him. And Stevens is terrified because love would complicate his tidy little world. And so, cowering behind all of that armor of his dignity, he tells her of his deep respect for her professionalism, and he says nothing of any personal feelings that he has for her as a woman. Well, finally, late in life, Stevens has one last chance to go to her. Now, I won't ruin the film for you by telling you what happens, but there's a particular symbolic scene that I'm going to describe. Somehow, a white pigeon gets into one of the sitting rooms at Darlington, and Stevens is beside himself. And he runs around, and he chases the pesky little intruder, and finally, he opens a window, and he throws the dove out. And at that point, in this brilliant piece of movie making, the camera angle shifts, and we're now seeing from the perspective of the dove. It flies up and up and up, and soon we realize that this is not the bird's eye view. We're seeing through the eyes of God. And we look down, and we see Stevens, and it seems as if we see him behind bars that obscure him from our view, and they trap him like an inmate in his castle. Dear friends, the love of God that is found in Jesus invades our tidy little worlds like a wild bird flying into our picture-perfect sitting room. God doesn't come to us as a decorative little model or figurine that we can place on the mantle. God comes into our lives as the great interrupter, the great disruptor of some of our best laid plans. This is the great chipin de cure. That's one of the names that I learned that our African friends on the island of Zanzibar that they have for God. Chipin de cure. And do you know what it means? It means the one who turns things upside down. That's what the Advent season does to us. Especially this year, it seems. It just turns everything upside down. It's the great inversion. God coming to earth in the form of a human being. The ruler of the cosmos trapped in a squalling package of helpless flesh. And this inversion flips all of our expectations. It flips all of our systems of power. And it flips all of our narratives that we've got on their head. Right now, I can imagine for some of you, it might feel as if your world has turned upside down already. So this may not sound very joyful. But this inversion, this chippen de cure, comes with expectant hope. That when the world seems to be all out of sorts, Jesus comes to be God with us. You may remember that just a few short weeks ago, all of the major media outlets were full with the announcement of the 2020 Nobel Peace Prize. You know how the Nobel Peace Prize came to be? It was established because of a huge, unexpected surprise in the life of Alfred Nobel. Nobel had been phenomenally successful as a businessman, and his business was the manufacture and the sale of weapons. He had spent a lifetime amassing a fortune as the inventor of dynamite, and then one morning, Alfred Nobel got up, opened the morning newspaper, and he read his own obituary on the front page. It was a simple journalistic error. His brother had died, and the newspaper printed the wrong biographical information. And the headline read, "Dynamite King Dead." And in that moment, Alfred Nobel saw how the world would remember him when he was gone. And guess what? He didn't like it. He didn't like it at all. So he went to work changing his legacy. And in his will, Alfred Nobel established the most prestigious prize on earth, awarded annually to the person or a group who does the most to promote peace in this world. The Nobel Peace Prize. Alfred Nobel's wake-up call was one of God's surprises. And when he heard that wake-up call, Alfred Nobel obeyed. Now, how about you this morning? How about all of us? Have you been surprised by an encounter with chippen de cure, the one who turns things upside down? Could that unwelcome surprise that has occurred in your life have been a wake-up call to you? Do you think that obeying God's voice like Alfred Nobel did, perhaps you could bring more peace and less dynamite here on earth, more goodwill and blessing and hope among all people? In verse 24 of our scripture lesson for today, we read what I think is the key about Joseph. In fact, I think it's the key to his life. Joseph did what the angel of the Lord had commanded. Joseph took that pregnant young woman as his bride, and soon thereafter, he was forced to flee for his life to a foreign country where he spent the next 2 years trying to learn Egyptian. We really don't know if he ever got that house of his dreams with the white picket fence and the nice yard. So was letting himself be surprised by God and obeying God's voice, was it worth it? Oh my gracious. Think of the joy in Joseph's life. I mean, he got to watch Jesus take his first baby steps. He got to watch that heavenly toddler grow up. He taught the boy his love of simple, honest work. Jesus grew up to be known as the carpenter. But nothing could be clearer as an expression of that special bond that Joseph and Jesus, that they had together, than the fact that when that boy became a preacher, when that boy became the messenger of God, he went out and he taught the entire world to call God the very word that he himself had called Joseph, the Hebrew word Abba, which translates into English as Daddy. So, the next time a monkey wrench drops into your well-oiled machinery, don't curse God. In fact, you might even take a moment to see that unwelcome surprise as maybe an opportunity to trust. Or maybe it's a gift to receive, or perhaps even it's a chance to obey. Because in the end, life gives us nothing we ever expected. But God gives us everything we ever dreamed of. You just ask Joseph. Let us pray. So this morning, friends, are you hearing any laughter from heaven? I'm not trying to be glib or trite this morning. But maybe, just maybe, it's a time of surrender for you. Maybe you've been planning and scheming and ordering everything in your life. And do you think that just maybe God's trying to break into your tidy, organized little world? Would you let him do that today? Gracious God, we admit that we are a people that don't like surprises. We work so hard to engineer those surprises right out of our life. And we want our lives and we want our schedules. We want it to run like clockwork. And then we hear your laughter from heaven. Help us, oh God, to receive those surprises just maybe as those opportunities to trust, maybe as that opportunity to respond to your call to act, or even when it goes against our plans. Oh God, today, on this third Sunday of Advent, break into our tidy little worlds and send your dove, that we might know your love, even as you sent Jesus into the life of Joseph. For this we pray. Amen. And now may the God that revealed himself as a baby born in a manger, may God reveal himself to you in the simplest of acts and the least likely of people this next week. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.